Riemann sum example using left-handed, right-handed, and trapezoidal approximations.
All right. So it says let f of x equal x cubed from 0 to 3. Use a Riemann sum and a trapezoidal sum to approximate that guy. You're thinking to yourself, ooh, I don't like that guy. But we do know something. This is where something really cool came from. It was our old notation that said, you know what, this really means the integral from a to b of f of x dx. Phew, that looks nasty. That I understand. This, I know a to b is our starting and our stopping value, f of x dx, I'm calculating area. So we know we're gonna go from 0 to 3 of a Riemann sum and a trapezoidal approximation. So step number one is let's figure out how we could cut it up. We can divide these up all different ways. We can choose approximations in terms of how we want to divide it up. How many rectangles do we want? Do we want an infinite number of rectangles? Do we want 5 rectangles, 3 rectangles? I have no idea. So typically, we tell you how many rectangles we want. We don't leave it to chance because then you'd have an infinite number of possibilities. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna start off with an easy division and we're gonna say equal widths, okay? So using equal widths. Now, equal widths, that means every width has to be exactly the same, which means step one, if I know I'm gonna go from 0 to 3, I need to somehow divide this up so they're equal. I have two choices. I can cut it in half and go 1.5 for either one, or I can say I can make 3 separate little rectangles and make each one a width of 1. Again, there's some choices here. Again, using equal widths, we can say and how many rectangles or trapezoids we want using equal widths, and we can say width 3 rectangles. Now, we've made this problem very, very simple, but what we're doing is we're showing you how this comes into play. You're given a function, you're given an interval. We're gonna find a Riemann sum or a trapezoidal approximation, and all of a sudden you saw that notation and you wigged out, and all of a sudden you realize, oh, no, no, that's nothing more than just the integral, no big deal. You keep reading and it says, using equal widths, that's fantastic. How many do we want? 3. Okay, so we're gonna divide this up into 3 rectangles. Well, that means there's 1 and there's 2, there's 3 rectangles. How did I come up with those really quickly? Well, we know if it's equal, that means delta x is always going to be your b minus a over the over n, which means it's your stop minus your start over the number of rectangles. Well, we know we start at 3, we stop at 3, we start at 0, and we want 3 rectangles to come out of this. So we have a start and a stop, and we want 3 rectangles. So we know each one has to be a width of 1, which is what you're seeing here. The width here is 1. For this green rectangle. The width for the blue is also 1. And the width for the purple is also 1. So now that we've done the basic part, let's now look at all of the possibilities. Let's do the left approximation. Well, that means if we know it's equal, we know we can take our delta x, our width, and we can pull out the width for each one of these, and we can then just add up all of the height values, which is fantastic, is what we need. We don't have to do each individual rectangle separately. We don't have to go 1 times its height, 1 times its height, 1 times its height, and add them up. We can do it all in one shot. So our delta x we have calculated to be 1. Now, which heights do we need? Well, if we want the left heights, We want the height on the left of the green rectangle. We want f of 0. And then if we are looking at the blue rectangle, we want the height on the left, which would be f of 1. And if we look at the purple rectangle, we want the height on the left, which would be f of 2. Now, that's awesome, but that's still not giving me an actual approximation. We're going to take these numbers and we're going to plug it into our function because f of x is x cubed, which means what we're really doing is the width, the height of 1 times 0 cubed plus 1 cubed plus 2 cubed. Again, these are the x values that it's happening. We're plugging it into our actual function to get a y value. This is the x times the y, the x times the y, the x times the y, base times the height for those three little rectangles. What we do now is it's 1 times 0 plus 1 plus 8, which gives us a value of 9. That's the approximation for the left-hand Riemann sum. Let's look at the right-hand Riemann sum. If I do the right-hand Riemann sum, again, we can use the idea that they have equal width, so we can factor out the width, 1. And what we're going to look at is the height on the right-hand side of the rectangle, which would be f of 1 this time. And then if I look at the blue rectangle, I'm looking at the height on the right-hand side of the blue, which would be f of 2. And then if I look at the purple, again, this time I want the height on the right, which means f of 3. So once again, if I distributed the 1 in, it would be width times height, width times height, width times height for each rectangle. But what are these heights? We're going to take these numbers, these x values, and plug it into our function to get y values. So what we're going to do is we've got the width, 1 times the height, which is 1 cubed plus 2 cubed plus 3 cubed. Well, if we simplify that, we get 1 times 1 plus 8 plus 27. We can do basic arithmetic and get our final answer. So what we're doing is, again, we're taking and putting a little number line, figuring out exactly what our widths are, and we're calculating left and the right Riemann sums. Now, let's look at the trapezoidal. If I do the trapezoidal, once again, if we have equal widths, we know they're all going to have a 1/2. They're all going to have the same width. And we're going to take everybody into consideration that we see. Every single height value has to be accounted for, because if we're looking at the trapezoid, every single height matters. So every single height for these trapezoids are important to us. But again, what was really cool was that the middle heights happen twice. The middle height here for 1 happens in the green and the blue. In the middle height here for 2 happens in the blue and the purple. So we're going to count them twice. So when we do that, what we're going to see is the first height, f of 0 on the far left, just goes once, f of 0, plus 2 times the summation of the two middle heights. What we're seeing is we've got f of 1, and we have f of 2. Those are our two middle heights that we're seeing because they're going twice. They share in the green and the blue, they share in the blue and the purple. And then we have our f of 3 value. What you're noticing is every single one of those number values appears, and we're doubling the middle. How do we get our final answer? We take these numbers and plug it into our function. So what we see is 1/2 times our width of 1 times f of 1, we know is 1 cubed, plus 2 times, we're going to plug in our values, 0, if we plug in 0. Forgive me. If we plug in 0, we get 0 cubed. And then we get 2 times, we have f of 1 and f of 2. So we've got 1 cubed plus 2 cubed. And then we have our f of 3 value to plug in, and we get 3 cubed. If we simplify all that arithmetic, we get 1/2 times 1 times 0 plus 2 times 1 plus 8 plus 27. Again, we can do the arithmetic to find what these approximations are. Now, which one's the most accurate is the question. Which one's an overestimation? Which one's an underestimation? And which one pretty much gives you the best choice? Well, the trapezoid will always give you the best approximation if you have to compare it with the left or the right. So So which one has the best choice? This one right here, the trapezoidal approximation, calculated everything that we needed. So he would be the most accurate answer. But if I was asked which one would be the underestimation or which one would be the overestimation, you can't say, well, my rectangles are underneath or my rectangles are above the curve. They want to know if you understand what the function is doing. Well, what is this function doing? F of x is increasing. So if we know f of x, this function is increasing. Well, that's going to be a really big indicator for what's happening for the area under the curve. If I use a left-handed approximations, I'm going to be under the curve. If I use right-handed approximations, I will be over the curve. So the left-hand approximation is an underestimation. The right-hand approximation is an over approximation, and the trapezoidal is the most accurate estimation. And the reason we know that is because the function is increasing. If the function was decreasing, we'd have to switch the idea of left and right being the over or under approximation. But once again, the trapezoidal will always be the most accurate we see. Let's look at another one.
For more examples just like this, in every topic in both Calc 1 and Calc 2, visit Calc Workshop today.